Welcome to Drinking Bros, presented by GhostBed.com. Welcome to Drinking Bros, kids. Look, we talk a lot of politics on the show. It is political season. There is a huge election, November 3rd. Obviously, we've talked a lot about Trump and Biden. You guys have reached out numerous times asking us to have some of the representatives of the Libertarian Party on the show. Jo Jorgensen or her VP running mates, Spike Cohen. So I hit up the campaign. Your manager was nice enough to get back to us. And welcome to the show, Spike Cohen. How are you, man?
I'm doing great, guys. Thanks for having me on.
Absolutely. Absolutely. First off, this is going to be a tough one. What did you think of the debate the other night?
Well, I mean, I think the winner was very clear. Every single American who has been telling everyone around them who would listen that there is no real difference between Trump and Biden, that they're both morons who are barely able to form a coherent sentence between them. Who really the only thing insightful they have to say is how terrible the other one is, and who have no real solutions to the problems that they and their parties have created. Those are the winners of that debate. Another winner of that debate was Jo Jorgensen. We saw a massive increase in interest as a result of people tuning into that debate, seeing that there wasn't a single viable option, there wasn't a single person up there that they wanted to vote for. And so they went onto the internet and desperately searched for anyone else that was running for that same office. And most of them ended up with, finding us and finding out more about our run. This is what we've been saying for years. If you want continuation of bad policies and the bad outcomes from those bad policies, if you want to continue to be ruled over by corrupt sociopathic clowns who can barely talk right, continue voting Republican. Continue wasting your vote for them. If you want to change how things are, if you want to take the power back from the cronies and the politicians who have been pandering and lying to you for decades, if you want to be able to thrive, if you want to be free, then you have to vote Libertarian.
So with that, why were you guys not invited to debates? Why was Jo Jorgensen not allowed to debate?
So the biggest thing there is that the Commission on Presidential Debates, which is a cartel that is owned by the Republicans and Democrats, have created a series of criteria for who is or is not allowed on the debate stage. One of those criteria is a minimum polling threshold. The problem is the polls don't include anyone else. They only include Trump and Biden.
And the problem is these polls, in my opinion, are fake. We saw it in 2016. We're seeing it now. I don't believe any of these numbers that we've seen in the media at all. So who determines that, and what's keeping the only candidate who is on the ballot? Because you're on the ballot in all 50 states, correct?
In all 50 states, plus DC and even on Guam.
So why would you leave off an actual candidate off the ballot, off that debate stage that night, if they're in every single state? Because look,
well, you know why. It's because it juxtaposes the absurdity of the binary political system, right?
You just saw in that debate outcome the reason why. Can you imagine if there was an actual adult who was able to present actual policies that would actually change the situation we're in there? Everyone would realize that that's the person they should be voting for. That's exactly why this Republican-owned cartel does everything they can to systematically deny the ability of other options. This is a nation of 350 million people. And we are seriously and unironically told that we have two choices. Yeah. They both suck, and you just have to choose one of them. You can't have even a third choice, much less four, five, six, seven choices. God forbid that you could have more than just the same two terrible choices over and over and over again, feeding you the same nonsense every single election cycle as they continue to create problems and make those problems worse. That is why we are denied. That is why Jo Jorgensen or anyone else wasn't on that stage with them, because literally anyone else could be on there. You could have put a jelly sandwich between the two of them and people would go, man, that sandwich looking good. That is how bad that debate outcome was.
Big fan of jelly, by the way.
So jelly's odd. Listen, yeah. Shout out to jelly.
Yeah, big ups to jelly.
Big ups to Smuckers.
So, well, I didn't want to go brand heavy necessarily.
They're not a sponsor, but they can be.
Smuckers
they
is good. Yeah. So, your supposition is that adding a third or additional party would be would help the dialogue. I'm sure that is true.
Oh, of course.
But what is it about your positions specifically that you think would be better than the positions of the two major candidates that are running right now?
Well, I mean, we've seen what the Republicrats have done. We've seen in over 160 years of exclusive Republicrat control of every lever of power and government in this country. We've seen what they've done with that control. They've used it to steal your power. They've used it to steal your freedom. They've used it to steal your money. They've used it to subjugate you and control you and stick you with the bill for doing it. And what have they done with that control? They've used it to enrich themselves and their well-heeled, politically connected billionaire cronies who have bought and paid for them to be in office. Every single bad outcome that we are facing right now is as a direct result of a system that they have created, whereby they have presumed the authority to take from us, to rob us, to subjugate us, to control us, to throw us in cages whenever they see fit. And in that kind of arrangement, how could we face anything other than the harmful and abusive and inequitable outcomes that we've come to expect from them? Of course we'd face that. They have a gun to all of our heads. They're telling us how to live our lives, and then they're robbing us. Of course it's going to lead to corruption. Of course it's going to lead to massive generational trauma and massive generational poverty. Of course it's going to lead to millions of Americans being thrown in cages and stuck with criminal records for engaging in victimless crimes like owning plants. Of course it's going to lead to increasing police brutality and an increasingly unaccountable and militarized police state. Of course it's going to lead to all of those harmful things because you're only given two choices. Those two choices work together every single day to make your life harder. What libertarians believe is that you do best, the people do best when we are free, when we have our power back, when we have our money back, when we have our freedom back and are able to work together to come up with the solutions to the issues that we face right. and our communities face without having more problems created by the people in power over us.
No, that is what the Libertarian Party proposes. Yeah, I certainly agree with that statement, but without actual policies behind it, it's just a platitude. So what are the policies behind your party that are going to make things like individual liberty more pervasive throughout American society? Because it's clearly not right now. By the way, FDR said fucking 90 years ago, we must especially beware of that small group of selfish men who would clip the wings of the American eagle in order to feather their own nest, right? Yeah. It's one of the most important quotes from a U.S. president in history, and nobody knows it. And it was a guy that served four terms as president, right? Mm-hmm. Saying this, and it's the role of government is shifted from supporting people to just, you know, continuing its own existence at this point, right?
I agree. With the Libertarian Party, what are the policies that are different than the Republican and Democratic parties that you're really trying to drive home?
Because I don't think a lot of people know the answer to that. I know exactly. Like, they understand the idea of individual liberty, and that's what makes the Libertarian Party super attractive to a lot of people. Mm-hmm. But what the actual policies that make that happen? And look, it's going to be, just for the audience, it's going to be an experiment because we've never done this before.
Right.
Right. There's going to be some hiccups. Like, let's say we elected a Libertarian today, and a third of the House and Senate were also Libertarian.
Right.
It's still going to take time to do things, and it's also going to be a fucking test. It's good. You have to try things and see if they work at scale.
Yeah.
That's in any business or any, I mean, you worked in websites and shit back in the day. You know how it is. Like, some tech works well down here. It doesn't scale. Right. So that's what we want to, that's what our people want to know. What are the actual
day-to-day policies? Absolutely. Yeah. So for example, the pandemic we're facing right now, what the Libertarian Party would have done is get rid of the regulations that made it so difficult for medical professionals to do their job and test COVID patients. Let's be very clear that the reason that we are facing a worse pandemic outbreak than any other developed country is because the Centers for Disease Control did not allow medical professionals to test and treat COVID patients for the first 2 months that the virus was here. That was crucial time that was lost. There were American companies that were making approved COVID-19 test kits and having to sell them overseas because it was illegal for them to sell them here.
Why was that?
Crucial time. I mean, in my opinion, big pharmaceutical industry, right? It's the reason that we pay $27 in the hospital for one aspirin, and the reason that you can go to Canada and get drugs one-fifth the cost you can in America right now. Right?
Yeah, that's another major problem.
I tried to get an antibody test, by the way, the other day, and I walked in, and they said it was $600.
Yeah.
It was not covered.
Just for the cheap one, it's $250.
Yeah. I'm like
holy shit, what? Dude.
Yeah.
And meanwhile, there are kits that are being made in this country and sold overseas that cost $25 to $50, including shipping. They're not legal here because they don't report those results to the government. here is what the problem is, and we are facing on every single thing. We would stop medical professionals from being banned from being able to do their job. When it comes to pharmaceuticals, we would end those ridiculous patent protections on drugs that have, some drugs that have been around for over 100 years, like insulin and epinephrine, that can be bought for pennies on the dollar overseas. We would end those protections. We would end the regulations that, according to recent studies, have contributed to 75% of the cost of healthcare. Three-quarters on every dollar that you are spending on healthcare goes to burdensome compliance laws.
Administrative fees. That's exactly what it is.
Administrative fees and regulations. You walk into a hospital, you see one doctor, two or three nurses, and like 15 administrators. They don't need those administrators except to demonstrate compliance with all of the different red tape. Get rid of all of that garbage. That was all put in place to necessarily drive up the cost of healthcare in order to make two things happen. Number one, make the cronies richer. No, actually three things. Number two, create a bureaucratic class that is reliant on those regulations to have jobs. And number three, to eventually make you just throw up your hands and say, you know what, let's just put the government in charge of the whole thing and they'll just control healthcare. Like, you know, the VA. And all you need to do is ask a veteran what the VA is like to see what the future that they have aimed for
us. You can ask, ask me anytime. We don't have time for me to go off on a VA rant right now. So let's our audience definitely knows.
You asked about policies. Here's a policy related to the VA. Okay. We found that it actually would cost less to give you the money directly to go and buy your own health plan. You could buy a Cadillac health insurance plan and get some of the best healthcare outcomes in this country, and it would cost less than this ridiculous system we have now where you're having to spend months, sometimes years, proving your percentage of disability before you get to see your first doctor or get your first treatment.
Yeah.
Our policy is to completely dismantle the VA and give the money directly to the veterans so you can go get the care that you need without having to prove that you need it.
Not opposed to that. I mean, for me personally, when I got out of the Army, it took me 930 days to get my first disability rating.
You're kidding.
Yep.
930 days. Now, Congress has passed some bills where they have to respond within 9 months. Mm-hmm. But still, why would it take 9 months?
9 months
to do that.
You could have had a baby, Dan.
Well, I did. I did. Man. Well, it wasn't mine. I mean, I just had a baby in my possession for a while.
Of course,
I gave it back. Yeah, I gave it back. But it was, you know, whatever.
You said once you give me my health care, I'll give the baby back.
I'll give the baby back, and that's
look. Now it's kind of starting to sound like a felony.
And he did it at Chili's.
It's starting to sound like a felony. By the way, I saw a meme this morning, and it said the next presidential debate is just going to be a bar fight at Chili's.
It should be. It should be. Speaking
yeah.
Speaking of the VA and the military, 80% of our audience is military and first responder. Mm-hmm. What is your stance on 2A in the Libertarian Party? And I'm asking, by the way, out of curiosity, because a lot of people don't know. Again, it's like Dan says, the Libertarian Party sounds sexy, but not a lot of people know the policies. Mm. Mostly, I'm not saying it's your fault. You're just not getting the media. Yeah. You're not getting the press for it. Here, at least you have 9.3 million listeners, so it's like, all right, great. What's your stance on 2A going forward for the future?
It is none of the government's business what arms you own. In fact, that's actually the law. The Second Amendment says very clearly that the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed, period. It does not say unless there's a crisis. Yeah. It does not say unless this gun is big and black and scary. It does not say unless it has more than a certain number of rounds. It says shall not be infringed. Common sense government control is the American people armed with whatever weaponry they feel they see fit to protect themselves and their loved ones and their communities, deciding what we allow the government to own. We have the exact opposite of what the founders intended, and we are facing the bad outcomes as a result of that. You look at the mass shootings that happen. Have you seen any mass shootings at gun shows or at gun rights rallies or at skeet shooting competitions or anything else? No. You see mass shootings at places that have large signs up everywhere saying you aren't allowed to have a gun here. Why? Because they know that they are going to have a soft target situation where they're the only one with a gun. Here's a story of two church shootings. I live in South Carolina, and in Charleston, South Carolina, Dylan Roof walked into Mother Emanuel Church and killed 13 people.
Yep.
That church did not allow firearms ownership in that church at the time. There was another shooting in a church, I forget where, in Texas last year, and someone showed up and tried to do a shooting there. He killed, I think, one person, and then two or three people shot and killed him. That is the difference between a mass shooting and getting mass shot. This is what this is one of many reasons why the American people should be able to own whatever weapons they see fit to protect themselves and their communities.
What about taxing the rich? That's another big one. I know that comes up on the Democratic Party side a lot, in particular with the socialists this year of Bernie Sanders and AOC and those guys. They want to tax the shit out of the rich. Where are you guys at on that?
What they're really saying is they want to tax the shit out of consumers. When you tax corporations, the wealthy, however you want to tax it, we could have a completely progressive rate where you don't pay a single penny of taxes until you make $100 million, and then you pay an 80% tax rate on anything over and above that, and the consumers would still be paying, and here's why. They just pass it on as overhead in the cost of the prices of the goods that they sell and rent to consumers, which means that the higher percent of your income that is being spent spent on buying things that you need, the higher your de facto tax rate is. All taxes are theft. All taxes are regressive. All taxes are an act of taking from those who have the least and giving to those who have the most. We believe that every other organization, if the three of us decided to start a business and the business model for funding it was to walk around with guns and point them at everyone and say, give me your money, give me as much money as I think you owe me, and I'm gonna give you something later. We'd all be in jail for racketeering, and rightfully so. There is absolutely no reason when every other person in an organization on the planet is able to fund themselves through voluntary means that the government cannot do so as well. The government has services. If those services are necessary, people will be willing to pay for them because they have a value and a demand. If they're not willing to pay for them, it means either that they don't want those services or they don't want government to provide them. In either case, government shouldn't be providing them. Government should be voluntarily funded just like any other organization. There is no reason that they should be exempt from what we would tell anyone else, that you can't rob people, you can't threaten people, you can't throw people in cages or threaten to hurt them because they won't give you money.
I think that is a very reductive view, to be honest. Like, I understand that people don't like taxes, and we all don't.
It's not an issue of liking. It's not an issue of liking taxes.
No, I got it. Let me finish here.
But hold on.
No, you hold on. This is my show. You hold on. So the idea that we're just not going to pay taxes unless we want to, that's absurd. That's never going
to
work.
It's not pay taxes unless we want to. It is paying fees for the services that we want.
For sure, right?
Let's
do some concrete examples of this. Like, you can't drive on the highways unless you pay a toll, right? Sometimes. That makes sense to me. That makes sense.
That is a fee for a service.
Yeah, exactly. So that's a good example of that. But other things like Medicare, for example. Not that that's a good program. It kind of sucks, and we could probably figure out a better solution. But the idea of us taking care of people that can't take care of themselves, you can't just rely on the goodwill of people all the time.
It's not about the goodwill of people.
Well, it is. It's not a service that you're getting personally. It's a service that we're putting money into a fund for that's going to help people that can't help themselves sometimes. Go ahead.
The ultimate reliance on the goodwill of people is relying on government to take as much money as they see fit and use it in ways that help people.
Right, but that's an either or logical fallacy, man. We're not talking about giving the government blind power versus, you know, not paying for anything. There's some balance in the middle where we pay a necessary amount. Like, you're just juxtaposing two fucking very radical sides of this argument.
Allow for voluntary funding. For example, a transfer fee that we could have on services where people can choose to pay a transfer fee. If they choose to pay that transfer fee, they have protection on that transfer. So, for example, if I sold you a car and there was a 3% or 5% transfer fee on that car,
right,
we could choose whether or not to pay that. If we don't pay that and there's some kind of dispute that happens, we can't sue each other. We can't use the court system to be able to arbitrate that,
right,
which means that we would want to pay that largely a nuisance fee to be able to do that. That funds far more than the cost of arbitration. That is a way that can voluntarily fund government. There are many other innovative ways, including direct fees for services, that government can fund everything that we need in order to be able to have a civil society built around a system of governance without having to force people to pay money. Here's what happens when we allow government to have the power to force us to pay them. It leads to the corruption we're facing. If I can rob you and everyone that's watching this whenever I see fit, I don't have to make good choices. I don't have to be a good steward of it, and I don't have to provide value because I can just take more whenever I want to. What the system we have right now is a system whereby people who are in power have presumed the authority to take from us whenever they see fit without having to provide any value.
Right,
what we are proposing in a system whereby government is voluntarily funded, they have to actually provide value to us in order for us to feel as though it is that the transfer fees or the voluntary fees for services or anything else that we are paying is something that we're actually going to be, that is worth us paying for. When you give government a blank check to take as much as they want, whenever they want to, we get the outcomes we face. We have more people who have needs. We have people in generational poverty. We have people in cages. All of that comes from a government that is able to write itself a blank check and stick you with the bill with interest.
Right. Not only is there no value, but there's no recourse against the government. Like there's no summit at the end of each year. We're like, hey, how did you guys spend all that money we gave you? No, they're just like, hey, we need more.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Exactly.
Like kind of kindly get fucked, sir, if you don't mind.
Yeah, exactly. And that's the problem.
So what about things like, I know this is, we're kind of getting into the weeds here, but people want to know what your guys' positions are. So what
Absolutely.
About,
yeah. And we want to educate more people because look, Dan and I firmly believe that there should be a third party, a third option.
I think there should be as many, I don't think there should be any political parties, actually. I don't think that idea that there is political parties or that there are political parties is absurd to me. Well, like, why are you organizing? You have to now, obviously.
Yes, but why need some form of
in general, back in the day, why was that ever a thing? Like the American Party. That's what I am because I care about America. I don't give a fuck about conservative or liberal or libertarian or that shit. What I care about is making the best solution for the most amount of people. That's what we should be doing as a government. Well, I mean, the train has already left the station on this one, right?
Right.
We got to do it now.
Some of the founders actually warned about the creation of political parties and the centralization of power into parties. The short answer to your question, why do we have parties? At this point, it's because we have to. Like,
yeah, we have
in
to
order
now.
To actually get on some state ballots, you have to be a part of a registered political party.
It's crazy, right?
It's now set in stone. Yeah,
like you could be the best candidate for a job ever, but unless you identify with one of these fucking major parties,
political party,
you can get like Jefferson hated this idea. Mm-hmm. And look, nobody is more responsible for the founding documents in this country than Thomas Jefferson. He fought hard against central banking, all the shit that Alexander Hamilton wanted. He fought hard against that bullshit.
Yeah.
And here we are. I think he would be justly embarrassed by what America's become at this point. I don't know where we go from here. I don't know how you stop the train that we're on and redirect it. You know what I mean? I would be like, all the things you guys talk about, not all the things, but a lot of the things you guys talk about make a lot of sense. But it's almost to me like a bunch of people sitting around a fucking campfire at night lamenting the fucking, you know, perils of the world and like, oh, we should do this and we should do that. It's easy to say that. How do you actually make any of this shit happen?
Yeah, because let's say you did get
elected. Because it's not
enough
to get elected. You have to have congresspeople and senators. Like elected all the same. That's what I think. I think you need to run. I think the Libertarian Party needs to somehow raise a bunch of money and run like 500 people for all kinds of down ballot seats and all this other shit all at the same time.
Yeah, because that was my next.
We are doing that.
Yeah, because my next question is, what if you did get elected, right? And then you got in there and you had to face the Senate and the House to try to get bills passed. You don't have anybody else on your party. Not that we're agreeing that there should be defined parties like this, but you would be a defined party at that point. You'd be up against Republicans and Democrats. How do you get anything passed once you're in there?
Right. So first of all, we are running down ballot candidates, hundreds of them across the country, up and down the ballot. Presumably, if we were able to win when we win the presidential election, that means there will also be some senators, some congressmen that are libertarians that will win. But we will be dealing with an overwhelming Republican.
And I think a lot of people still, I think a lot of people in traditional politics lean that way. They just don't have the option. If you're in a major district as a congressperson, you can't run as a libertarian right now.
No.
Like in some of them, you can, right? And win. But most of the people, I think if a libertarian president won, that a lot of people would switch parties. I think a lot of people from the left and the right that are mostly centrist would leave. That would be one way to do it. But how do you know, do you guys track on how many people you have running and in what districts? Like, do you have... one of the most important things about running a national campaign or even a statewide campaign is to help the down ballot people, right? Because rising tide lifts all boats, obviously. Mm-hmm. And the more people you can get elected, the more authority you're going to have wherever you go. Not just actual authority, but also authority with the community because people realize you're legitimate at that point.
Right.
So
absolutely.
Are you guys tracking on all that? Are you guys doing campaign events? I mean, it's COVID time, so it's hard to do anything. But.
Absolutely. I'm traveling the country right now, and so is my running mate. And we are doing exactly that on the bus tour, on fly ahead tours. We are having joint meetings and rallies and fundraisers with down ballot candidates. We have over 1,000 people running across the country. And why do so many people very active in
this is the question I have for you, because you're obviously a smart dude and you've been out there in the public a lot, probably mostly around people who understand and like your ideology, but I'm sure you run into a lot of people who don't. So here's what I don't understand. Why does the idea of libertarianism seem so crazy to people? Is it because they become, are they just institutionalized at this point? Because it's not that crazy. It's not crazy at all, actually.
If you picture an increasing number of Americans are conditioned into believing that they're the only way that they're going to be able to live their lives is if better people than them are controlling their life. Now, what's weird is that a lot of them also recognize that the people in charge are total idiots and sociopaths and morons, but they're still told, you know, presumed authority is good. They're going to do things better than you possibly ever could. And they operate from that assumption. There's also a lot of fear. When I go around to to college students and protesters and housing projects and gun rights rallies, I see a lot of people who are scared. And when people are scared, when people are anxious, when people are increasingly hopeless, it's that much easier to control them. It's that much easier for someone like a Republican or Democrat to show up and go, everything will be fine if you just put me in charge. If you just give me a little bit more control and a little bit more of your money, then you'll be safe, then you'll be happy, then you'll be healthy, then everything will be fine. Because even though it intuitively doesn't make sense, it is a desperate hope that, okay, fine, if I'll just give them the power, then they'll be in control and then I won't have to worry about it and everything will be fine. It is a fear-based thing. It's the same thing that makes people vote for one of those two morons that was in that debate out of the sheer hope that they'll be better than the other moron that they hate a little bit more.
I mean, it's probably just intellectual laziness too, I think, to be honest. I think people just don't want to think about it. They just want to go about their lives. They want their iPads and Hot Pockets and no distractions.
Correct. And they also know that if you did elect a libertarian candidate, there would be a lot of hiccups. There would be a lot of work. And
since when does America fucking shy away from doing hard work?
Now.
Goddamn. When did that change? Because we used to be kind of tough. Do you remember the 50s and shit?
Yeah.
Or maybe the 30s and 40s.
Cigarettes. No filters.
We didn't have to get into a war. We just kind of like, hey, you know what? The world's in danger. We're going to go fucking murder a bunch of people. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like that's how we used to decide how to go to war. Now it's like, kind of feel like we should go to war.
Yeah.
Why not? Let's do it. When Ben Franklin said those who would give up essential liberty to purchase a little temporary safety, then they deserve neither.
Deserve neither.
Right?
Yeah.
We've completely lost that entire sense of what it is. America is not Republicans or Democrats or libertarians. It's not white people. It's not Native Americans. It's not black people. It's not fucking, it's not football. It's none of that shit. It's not fucking Budweiser. It is liberty. That is the essence of America. That is the entire point. It's the reason we created this goddamn country.
Right.
And it seems like we've just completely gone off the rails and it's become a popularity contest between two sets of very flawed ideologies.
Yeah.
And I just don't understand how it got this far. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and have you thought about that in particular? Because we talk about this on the show all the time. We've also talked about Kanye, right? Buying his way onto some of the ballots in, I believe, 5 or 6 states. Now, Joe Jorgensen, who I believe we're going to have on the show in like a week or so, who you're obviously running with, is not the most personable, like out of control personality and can grab a lot of headlines. Do you think that's part of it? Is it going to take somebody like I hate to say like a Trump because he's so out of control, obviously, but
he's a populist. He's an entertaining guy.
Correct. Right? Is it going to take somebody like that to break through with this? You know, you take Michael Bloomberg in this election.
He's the most,
for example.
He may as well have been Al Gore. To me, he's the or Lurch. What the fuck is his name? Kerry, John Kerry.
Right.
Like you cannot run a fucking old white boring dude for anything.
I agree.
It just doesn't work.
Policy wise, he probably would have matched up more in the middle.
Yeah.
And with
for
his
sure,
money,
yeah.
He would have been able to buy a bunch of shit. What is exciting about Joe Jorgensen that the people don't know?
Well, Joe Jorgensen is a brilliant self-made entrepreneur. She's someone that, and it's sad that this is even a hurdle we have to cross. We don't have to worry about whether or not she's going to pass a cognitive test. That's apparently, it's not a high hurdle, but we jump it with great gusto. Joe Jorgensen has demonstrated in her life's work that she knows how to solve problems, that she knows how to create and run successful organizations without going bankrupt or using eminent domain to try to, you know, force other people allow her to buy their properties or use bankruptcy courts to unload her debts on others. She has demonstrated an ability to lead from day one, not by taking control from you, but by giving it back to you. To answer your question, I want to go back. You had asked about, you know, when we get elected, how do we deal with the fact that the vast majority of people in office in Congress are not going to be libertarians and may not want to work with us. Part of the silver lining, if you will, to the fact that Congress has over the past several decades so abdicated their responsibility in creating one alphabet soup agency after the next and giving them nearly unlimited regulatory authority is that when Joe gets into office, Donald Trump and Joe and Barack Obama would have bragged a lot about their pen and their pad. She'll have a giant eraser and shredder to be able to undo a lot of those bad regulatory burdens and regulations at the executive level. Now, of course, there's a lot of stuff that also needs to be done at the legislative level as well. And we will negotiate to whatever extent we can. I believe when the American people see the immediate and profound benefit of those eliminations of regulations that are done at the executive level, that will give us more bargaining position to get more at the legislative level. And if need be, to replace a lot of them who won't work with us by showing the people that they want to keep the boot on the neck of the people and allow continued needless suffering for no other reason than to preserve their own power and the wealth of the cronies that bought for them to be in office.
Yeah, we've dealt with this a number of times with politicians on both sides of the aisle. When I say us, I mean this show specifically. For example, Lindsey Graham from my home state as well. I'm from Greenville, South Carolina. That guy, that guy's a giant piece of shit. First of all, he's a 35-year reserve JAG officer in the Air Force, like an attorney, right? Now he's been in politics for the majority of his adult life. Our buddy Richard Stasekall, he's a sergeant first class in Special Forces, and because of medical malpractice through the military, now has cancer, right? Like they created the conditions for him to get cancer. And because of, various federal laws, he was unable to sue the government to get recompense for what the fuck they did to him. Now, the only guy standing in the way was, and most of our audience is pretty conservative and libertarian. They're not a lot of fucking liberals that listen to us. But if somebody fucks with my tribe, I'm coming after you. I don't give a shit what fucking letter you have on your collar. I don't give a shit about that.
Right.
And it was only Lindsey Graham standing in the way of this man getting justice because he was the chair of the Judiciary Committee, right? He wouldn't let it go. In the House, they let it go to budgeting. They added it to they eventually, because of a lot of effort, including his attorney, Natalie Kwam, they added it to the NDAA for last year, right? So now he can sue. But man, it seems like now more than ever, maybe because of social media, maybe because of cancel culture, I don't know what it is, but it seems like you can really affect politics using digital media these days in a way that you couldn't before. And I think you're right. I think if people saw libertarians as a legitimate power, then you would be able to really shame other people into doing things that are good for Americans. I genuinely believe that.
Yeah. And I look, and I hope it's not to look down negatively on your candidates, but I think somebody like you actually should be running where you're clearly tech savvy. You've got a podcast. That is one of the most prominent things that is on your resume here is your podcasting and things like that. That is the future, to get out your message to the masses without having to deal with the media. Because I personally believe that the media is all fucking rigged at this point.
Oh yeah, it is for sure.
Because I you don't read one goddamn thing about the Libertarian Party at all.
No.
Everybody wants you to get...
They have done everything they can to shut us out.
Correct. Yeah. And they'll continue to do it as well.
And as well as Trump. And, you know, they clearly want Joe Biden in there because of their own interest. Is there any thought of you possibly running in the future if, you know, this doesn't work out?
Yeah, I mean, that's very premature to talk about, and I appreciate you bringing that up. I do want to say one thing about Joe. Joe also is a tech startup a business owner. I mean, that is where her background comes from, is from tech startups.
To politics. People think that, like, whenever something new happens, people are like, oh, this is like CBD is a good example of that. Mm-hmm. People are like, oh, CBD, it's a new fad. No, actually, the Israelis have been studying CBD since the 1950s, guy. What the fuck are you talking about? Yep. 70 years now. We have 70 years of research on this stuff. Think we're good. Yep. Calm the fuck down. She's been in politics since the early 90s.
Again, a lot of this is lack of knowledge. So someone like me, dude, I don't I read probably 10 newspapers every single morning that I get up just to try to stay in touch with everything.
The only
we're on every single
the
day.
The only way you guys are getting into paper, by the way, is if one of you walks out in the street and shoots somebody. You
correct.
Know what I mean?
That's
I,
the like only. We got, so the one time we got national media attention was when Joe got bitten by a bat. And we got a massive, we got a huge bump in the polls. And the reason we got a big bump in the polls was because people said, oh, the Libertarians are running someone this year. Let's look into that. Yeah. We actually got a bump. Another reason we got a bump was because she got bitten by a freaking bat and immediately got on an airplane and continued campaigning just to show how tough and
so
and
what you're saying
is,
Joe Jorgensen is COVID patient zero in America.
That yeah, what that's what we're saying.
Good. You heard it here first.
I cannot confirm or deny if Joe Jorgensen has secret magical bat powers from being bitten by the bat.
Yeah, because, you know, for me, again, going back to like how much I read every single day, because I do two shows that are on daily. If it weren't for our listeners reaching out over and over and over again, asking us to get you guys on the show to talk about the Libertarian Party, I would not have known you were running. Because, you know, typically you hear about Jill Stein, right? And that's it. And it's like, oh, Jill Stein lost the election for the Democrats in 2016. What do you say to people who, look, if this vote comes down to 1 or 2 points versus Biden or Trump, what do you say to the people who say, fuck you guys for voting for Joe Jorgensen and Spike Cohen?
If our running potentially loses the race for someone else, they shouldn't have run such a terrible candidate. We have a very devious
plan. I 100% agree, by the way. Yes.
We have a very devious plan to take votes from Joe Biden and Donald Trump, thereby making them both lose and us win. We are not running as spoilers. We are running to show that they are the spoilers. Mm. They are spoiling things for the American people. They are encouraging you to waste your vote and throw your vote away for the very people and parties that created the mess that we're in now. That's wasting your vote. We are giving you an opportunity to vote for change that will actually change things. Not just the phrase change, not just the phrase hope, but actual policies that dismantle these bad policies and the outcomes that we're getting from them and put the power and the freedom and the wealth back in your hands.
It sounds 100% like you think you're going to win.
We have to run to win. We always run to win. And because if I show up and I say, hey, guys, I'm Spike Cohen and I'm here to get 5% immediately. We have hundreds of thousands of people around the country who are knocking on doors and doing phone calls to their loved ones about our campaign and doing sign waving and doing caravans and showing up at our rallies and our events and everything else. We have to run to win. Up and down the ticket, we have to run to win. We know what challenges we face. We know what our odds are facing into it, but we have to run to win. And we have to present a positive and proactive dialogue on what we will do when we get elected. If we don't get elected, we'll do better than we've ever done before. And we move forward on the momentum from that to the next election cycle and run to win in that cycle. The idea of competing in something and not trying to win is a loser's game in my mind. If I'm going and I'm playing a game of basketball against a professional basketball player, which is not really a good example because in this case, we're far more professional than the people that we're running against. But if I'm in a hopeless odd or an odd that has very low chances of me winning, if I'm not going to do it to win, I might as well not do it. We are running to win.
Well, I mean, Gary Johnson got 4.5 million votes last time.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Which is a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's a lot. That's a lot of people in general. It's not a lot compared to the 60 million or 62 million it takes to actually win an election, but it's
that's a decent chunk, man.
It's definitely a lot of people that you can put out on the street with clipboards. You know what I mean? Because
mm-hmm. Exactly.
Honestly,
exactly.
I don't know. I mean, you got to do shows like this. You got to do alternative media, if you want to call it that, because the traditional media isn't. They're going to continue to fuck you guys over. There's no chance they're ever giving you a platform. I certainly wouldn't count on it.
They can't, yeah.
They can't. Yeah. Here's why they can't. The major news media, the dying corny crony corporate media, is owned by 6 multinational trillion-dollar companies that have a vested interest in keeping the system in place.
Yeah.
This is what they want. Of course they're not. This is, you know, when we watch the Hunger Games and there's this, you know, this entertainment news that's run by the oligarchs, that's what we have right now. Of course they don't want us in because they know when we get into power that we'll completely dismantle their gravy train. That federal trough of endless tax dollars that they get, that's all over. They have to go and pull themselves up by their bootstraps. jobs and live within their means and do all the stuff they tell us to do and try to actually provide value instead of just sucking from the teat of the American worker and the American taxpayer.
Yeah, and it's happening in all forms of media, like not just traditional newspapers. Like
social media.
Yeah, the Washington Post and everything. All of social media, all of, on my side, because I'm a Hollywood guy, all of Hollywood is now owned by one person. There's a guy named Jay Penske who has just bought The Hollywood Reporter, Variety, Deadline, which they own the Golden Globes, Dick Clark Productions, all that stuff. So they're all for Biden as well. They're all for Democrats. So they have a vested interest in keeping you guys out of the media as well, even in Hollywood. And let's face it, you do need celebrity endorsements here and there to get, you know, the word out. I mean, I don't know how much Biden paid The Rock to do that fucking Instagram video, but I can guarantee you some money changed hands.
I doubt he paid him. What my guess is, just from having worked in politics, my guess is he offered him some kind of position similar to what Obama offered Cal Penn back in the day.
Ah.
Right?
Yeah.
Like you offer him some kind of administrative position in the campaign, or not in the campaign, but in the administration, and that kind of maybe sets the stage for you to run for something in the future.
Mm.
That's my guess. Although The Rock,
and even if there's not a direct thing like that, which is very possible, it's just the fact that they know that it'll keep the regulations and burdens in place that keep them preserved in their wealth and stop any smaller innovative competitors from being able to come up and threaten their position of power. I mean, it this is about preserving power. And of course, they're going to do everything they can to shut out not just our voice, but any other third party or fourth party choices or any other independent choice. Kanye West, who is a literal billionaire.
Yeah.
Who everyone knows, he was only able to get on like 6 or 7 state ballots because he didn't run as a Republican.
Right.
The
right.
only organization in this country that has the ground game to actually get on all 50 state ballots plus DC, besides the Republicans, is the Libertarian Party, because we've been doing this for 49 years.
Have you guys thought at all about
the kind of power entrenched we're dealing with?
Have you guys thought at all about not teaming up, I guess is kind of a weird way to say this, but teaming up with other, you know, not Democrat or Republican parties, like Green Party, or if there's a Labor Party that pops up or something like that. Have you guys thought about pairing with them and trying to, you know, work together to legitimize both things? Because look, it's not bad. It's not a bad thing if there's more choices ever.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
There should always be, there should be the choices, at least for how we run our government, should be unlimited.
Mm-hmm.
Because you have to, the point should be to arrive at the correct answer at some point. And if you limit your choices, that becomes impossible. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like you can either have salt or sugar. Well, I need fat though.
Right.
To survive, I need fat and protein. Like, you can have salt or sugar. Get fucked.
Yeah.
Like, oh, great. Great. So have you thought about that at all? Like, I mean, and who would even be viable? I mean, the Green Party's been around for a while too, but are there other like non-traditional parties that even exist?
I don't believe so, right?
So outside of the Green Party, the I guess the three largest third parties out there are the Libertarian Party, which is the third largest party in the country, followed by the Green Party, and then the probably the Constitution Party after that. We do coalition with those parties on things like ballot access lawsuits, on things like referendums for ranked choice voting and loosening of ballot access restrictions, advocacy for that kind of stuff. We don't really team up with them in terms of like trying to get votes. And the reason why is because what we're proposing and what the Greens are proposing are very, very different things.
Right.
And so it would be hard for us to say, well, you know, you should vote for the Libertarian Green Coalition because, well, what set of policies are we running for? There are many things that we agree on, like ending the wars overseas, ending the war on drugs, criminal justice reform. There are many things we agree on, but there's a lot that we don't agree on. So which set of policies will we be supporting there? But we definitely work together with third parties and independents all the time to increase the number of choices that Americans have with ballot access lawsuits, allow Americans to be able to do ranked choice voting, which instead of just giving your vote to one person, one party, you can actually rank who you want to give it to, you know, give, you know, your top pick to the Libertarian Party and your second pick to the Greens and your third pick to the whoever else you want to give it to, or, you know, which.
So it works more like college football rankings. Then,
yeah. Or a caucus.
It's like a caucus.
That's interesting.
It is interesting. Yeah. What's your stance on marijuana? Obviously we're huge on it here and we think it should be legalized in this country. Where are you guys at on that issue?
fully legalized. It's none of the government's business what you put in your body. And when it tries to make it its business, it just leads to, in the case of harder drugs, more addiction, criminal cartels being in charge of who is of selling it. Those criminal cartels become incredibly powerful. So then they pay off police officers and government officials, which leads to more government corruption. It makes our streets less safe. We saw all of this with alcohol prohibition. We're now seeing it with the war on drugs. We believe that the way to deal with the war on drugs, including with marijuana, is to legalize it and to allow people to get the help they need if they're addicted. In the case of marijuana, which is not really addictive and has never actually killed anyone,
right,
it's one of the safest drugs out there. We believe in full legalization. We believe in expunging the records of anyone who has any kind of marijuana crime on their record, so that that's no longer hanging over their heads, freeing anyone from the prisons that are in there for anything related to marijuana.
Well, it's 30% of people in prisons, 30%
that's
or
right.
so,
yeah,
are
that's
in there for some weed-related
offense.
One out of every
three, yep.
And in federal prison, only 5% of everybody in federal prison right now is in federal prison for some violent offense.
Yep.
5% of the entire federal prison population is in prison for a federal or for a violent offense.
Yeah.
That should
make you feel some kind of way, honestly.
Yeah.
It should make you feel
prisons,
like nauseous.
Prisons are for people that are a demonstrated threat to the public. We believe that if you were in jail for a victimless crime, like anything related to drugs, you shouldn't have ever even gone to jail.
Right.
We believe that there are other crimes like petty theft and shoplifting and things like that, that there are better ways to deal with that than throwing the person in a cage, which ruins their life. And it almost assures that they're going to lead to a life of crime if and when they ever get out,
but
because all of their other options have been taken from them because of their felony record.
And it's a red herring too, these small-time crimes, because we know the biggest predictor of crime is actually poverty. Like, we know that. And the fact
that's
that these
right.
two, the Democrats have tried to keep black people on welfare, right? Because they want that control. They want that vote. Mm-hmm. And the Republicans have done a very bad job of trying to battle that. Like, it started with racism, and now it's just like, oh, fucking, we can't do this. I don't hear any Republican out on the stump right now talking about individual liberty and entrepreneurship as a way to heal the black community. Because that's what it is. Really. That's how you do it. You don't do it by fucking, we'll talk about this in the fake news later, but California passed a bill for a little group of people to discuss reparations in California, right?
Yeah, I just saw that with Gavin Newsom.
Yeah. So, I mean, the idea, the fact that they put a panel together to discuss it first is promising, but it's California, so you know where it's going to go. Come on.
Yeah,
it's
going
to go as far left as they can possibly get, but it's definitely a conversation that needs to be had. And look at all of human history. Crime is predicted most frequently by poverty first.
That's right.
And two, we've robbed $1 trillion out of the black community. By we, I mean the American government has done that.
Yep.
So obviously there's an issue to deal with. I don't know why people can't just admit that these are facts. It's math, right?
Mm-hmm.
Why can't we just admit that and be like, oh, well, we have to deal with that? Because if you've got like a backache and you start, running, it's going to feel like something, right?
Yeah, I just think
you can't just ignore
it. It's too late for reparations right now.
No, reparations will never, ever work.
Yeah.
We've seen it. Remember the Bush tax cut with that $300 check that came out in 2004, I think it was.
Yeah.
Or 2004 or 5, I don't know what year it was. But that and then three other occasions through the 80s and 90s that happened where people got money back. We know that people do not put that in savings. They don't pay off bills. They go out and spend it.
I bought a Motorola Sidekick with that check.
Yeah, people go out and immediately spend that money because it's money that did not exist to them.
Correct.
It doesn't register in their brain as money. So the idea that you're just going to give lump sums to people is the dumbest shit I've ever heard of in my life. Plus, it's not generational wealth, which is the real problem here. Entrepreneurship is real generational wealth.
Yeah,
but I don't hear anybody talking about this.
I actually talk about it quite a bit. And in fact, when I went on tours in campaigning in housing projects, knocking on doors and talking with people who have almost nothing, almost every single one of them had some kind of business side hustle that they have to keep small because they can't afford the tens or hundreds of thousands of dollars in licensing fees and compliance costs to be able to do it legally.
Mm-hmm.
So here, and this is stuff like braiding hair, mowing lawns, doing electrical work, doing plumbing work, doing roofing work. These are people who know how to do these things. They do it amazingly well, but they have to keep their business small and they can't market. And I mean, I had a successful business and marketing was the name of the game.
Yep.
They can't market it because if they did that, the police show up, seize everything they have with civil asset forfeiture, possibly even kick them out of public housing. And now they have nothing. So instead they keep it small. It makes just enough money for them to be able to have a little money on the side. But if they were able to just be able to grow those businesses, they'd be able to grow directly out of poverty and grow into prosperity and pull their communities up like every other community has been able to do. If we simply get rid of the burdens and barriers that they are facing, not remove the social safety net, just put the ladders back so they can climb out of it, they aren't going to be dealing with generational poverty. Yeah. They'll have generational wealth to hand on and build a financial and economic legacy for themselves and their families and for their communities.
I agree.
The only country that's ever figured this out, by the way, is Sweden.
Sweden, yeah.
If you are unemployed in Sweden, the government's like, they're not like, here's 50 weeks worth of $350. It's not that. Like, they'll help you in the meantime, but they find you a career. Like, right. If you, let's say you were in a, let's say Sweden's politics were mapped onto America and coal mining is going away. They're like, all right, we got to take all these people and find a new career for them right now. Otherwise, and it's fucking smart. It's not socialism. It's smart. These people are going to become a burden if they don't have the access to entrepreneurship in this country. That is, it's fucking A and B, dude. It's, that's how it works. So if you don't take care of that issue, and that's what they do, they take care of the issue. They fucking retrain you or whatever. And they use private industry. They pay private industry to retrain you and then find you fucking careers, not jobs, careers, right? And then you go back into the workplace. That's how it works. Here, we can't do it because, like, again, the left wants to keep these people down and dependent on the government. And the right just doesn't seem to care, frankly.
No, and since we are talking about the economy, you know, a lot of people were big on Andrew Yang. Now, he ran as a Democrat. I didn't think he was a Democrat. But, you know, his big thing was universal income, right?
UBI,
UBI. This universal basic income. Where are you at on that? Is that something that you think is necessary for the future because so many jobs will be taken by AI and robots and all that stuff?
So UBI recognizes two things. Number one, it recognizes that we have a problem whereby an increasing number of people are going to be unemployable. The other thing it recognizes is that our current system is UBI for billionaires. We have universal basic income for multinational trillion-dollar companies and the billionaires who operate them. And we are all robbed to pay for it. Here is the long-term issue. And all of that needs to end. Andrew Yang and I and the Libertarian Party agree 100% that we need to end the corporate welfare. We need to end UBI for billionaires. We need to end the system of confiscating from those who have the least and giving to those who have the most. Here is the long-term issue with UBI. Number one, whenever you have a system whereby lots of people are being given money, that means a massive inflation of the monetary supply. That means the Federal Reserve printing out endless Federal Reserve notes, even at a greater clip than they're doing now, in order to be able to pay for this, right? Mm-hmm. So what does that do? We've seen what that does. In the last 107 years that the Federal Reserve has existed, the dollar bills that we're using have lost 98 cents on the value, on the dollar of their value. Imagine if your money was worth 50 times what it's worth right now. That's how much they robbed you.
Yeah, relative to inflation.
Yeah, just due to inflation as a direct result of the inflating the monetary supply. So what UBI would do was massively inflate that so that the cost of living continues to go up. That coupled with the fact that you would be empowering politicians to be able to run solely on how much money they're giving everyone. Where I show up and I go, hey, everyone, I'm Spike Cohen and I'm going to give you $2,500 a month. And you show up and you go, no. Spike Cohen doesn't care about you. I'm going to give you $3,500 a month. And you show up and you go, well, they neither, those two schmucks don't give a crap about you. I'll give you $5,000 a month. That coupled with the inflation aspect of it creates a snowball effect where more inflation leads to more pandering, which leads to more money, which leads to lower inflation, which means to more pandering, which leads to more money. And eventually we're in a situation like Zimbabwe or another country where we end up having to use someone else's currency to live because ours is worthless, which means an end to UBI and everything else as well. What libertarians propose is getting government out of the currency game to begin with. That is the problem. That is why your money's worthless and worth less every single day. It's because government has a vested interest in your money losing value so that you become more anxious over time and so that the value of their debts goes down over time. Instead, we propose putting the name of currency, putting the game of currency in the free market, where now, instead of having a monopoly providing you with your currency, now there are people who have a vested interest in your currency gaining value over time so that you don't go to one of their competitors who has their currency gaining more value. Relates the other issue with that is the unemployability. And this is a problem that is related to the corporate structure that is basically mandated by our tax code. Because of our system, things like worker-owned co-ops are prohibitively expensive to be able to do, and in some cases illegal to do, because of the tax codes that are built in for what would happen if you tried to create one and what kind of tax liabilities you would have compared to if you're just a regular corporation. As a result of that, these people who have been working their whole lives immediately become unemployable and have absolutely zero equity in the companies that they've been working on. We propose getting rid of these tax codes that are creating these situations so that you can have workers have more direct ownership of the actual means of production. Not through some kind of seizing of the means or anything like that, not some socialist thing, but because of them just voluntarily being able to do this, being able to get more involved in the ownership of their companies and have those types of things, so that when automation over time, it's not going to be as fast as they're saying, but over the next few generations, increasingly becomes how everything is done, people will actually have equity in the firms that are providing these things. That, coupled with free market currency, largely deals with those issues without creating this snowball effect of ever hyperinflation that would necessarily come from UBI and other similar plans.
But dealing with creative destruction in economics has been a problem throughout human history. I mean, anytime people are displaced from work by some new technology, the cotton gin or AI, whatever it happens to be, right?
RIP Eli Whitney, by the way.
He's been gone for a while, but yeah. It's you have to do something about it. I don't think the answer, in my opinion, the answer will never be relying on the government to give you more money, because If you're relying on government, they don't have to seize the means of production if the means of production becomes unattainable for Americans, right? And the next thing that happens, once the means of production is out of the hands of the individual Americans, it's socialism, right? It just happens. There's no way to stop it at that point. So the UBI seems like it's one of those things that seems like a good idea. Like, yeah, we probably are going to have to deal with this. He's right. He diagnosed the problem, but his solution is fucked. Like, you just can't do that. There's no way.
Right. Let me switch gears here and talk about Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg. If you guys were to get into office, what happens when you nominate a Supreme Court justice to replace somebody like RBG? Is there libertarian judges? And I know I probably sound like an idiot for asking this, but is there libertarian justices out there that you guys would put on the court, and how would that pass through Senate and I guess the House is what I'm curious about.
Well, it would just be the Senate.
So there are some libertarian judges out there, like Andrew Napolitano, Don Willett. Another one is Judge Jim Gray. He actually ran for vice president in 2012. He was one of the first high-level judges that was refusing to prosecute drug crimes because he said the war on drugs needed to end. The short answer, I'm not going to put names in Joe's mouth because that's something I defer to her on the actual specific people.
Of course.
That she would point. Yeah. But in terms of what kind of justice they would be, the job of a justice is not to decide how things should or should not be. Their job is to interpret the law. And in this case, the law being the Constitution of the United States. And if there's any discrepancy or nuance as to what it means, referring to the writings of the founders, usually through the Federalist Papers and other writings, to determine what they actually meant when they wrote the Constitution, period. That is their job. At any time that there is any kind of gap or discrepancy there, they would need to err on the side of maximizing human liberty over greater control from government. Those are the kind of justices we would point.
Gotcha. Because and again, like I said at the top of the show, the reason I'm asking a lot of these questions is because I don't know. I am one of the dummies that Dan described earlier, where it's like, dude, I'm thinking about my hot pocket. I'm thinking about my child's soccer practice tonight. For me, it is a big idea to elect a party that I know nothing about, when I'm just trying to get through the day with maybe, I sleep 4 or 5 hours a night, right? Trying to add whatever complications and hiccups and bumps down the road of another party coming into power right now. I am one of those people that, on the show, look, Dan is in the middle. He hates both parties. I lean right simply because I don't believe with a lot of things on the left. I'm also not full right of like, I believe in everything in the Republican Party. However, it is easier for me to get through my day of like, all right, well, shit, this is going to be fine, and it's not going to fuck up my life for the next 4 years that much. I think I speak for a lot of people out there, because we're in the same boat of like, man, I've got a family and jobs and all this other stuff in a company that I'm trying to run. It's like, I don't have time to put this much mental energy into it. What is the solution for people like me? Again, you're not going to get any help from the media at all in this.
And a big solution to that is, and this is more like a long-term holistic look at it. Mm-hmm. The reason you're in the situation you're in is intentional. They want you to be up to here with just trying to get by in life. They want you to be, you know, floating just above water and doing everything you can to be able to provide for yourself and your loved
ones.
Soma. That's why they want the
cost of living
from Brave to go up.
It's Soma from Brave New World. They want to be able to give you a pill and you just be compliant.
Right.
But in this case, the pill or the conditions economically that they've set up for this country. It's fucked up.
Exactly.
I mean, if you can't see that, if you can't see that both these parties don't give a fuck about you, and look, I'm not endorsing libertarians. I'm just saying the Republicans and Democrats definitely don't give a fuck about you, and you can tell.
Here's the thing. You can see it with your own eyeballs right now. I know that answer, right? Yeah. And I know politicians don't care about me, and I know they never will, right? If something were to happen to me, they don't give a shit. I'm just a number, one out of 330 million people. I'm just saying for me personally, it makes my days easier where it's just like, all right, great. Yeah. The reason why we have people like you on a show like this is to educate people, is to get the word out, and it is to provide some other option that hopefully in the future will come to fruition. Do I think it's going to be in this election? Absolutely not. Do I admire you guys going out and doing this every day? You bet, man, because you are really fighting the good fight every single day. And to those who are curious at home of like, hey, man, why the fuck would you have them on if they're not going to win and give them a voice? Everybody deserves a voice in this country. And if you were so close-minded that you were unable to hear that, then you're the fucking idiots. You know. So, look, I greatly appreciate your time today. I have a couple more questions here before I let you go.
Absolutely.
I read that you were diagnosed with multiple sclerosis and at the age of 33 years old. Another dummy question. That's lifelong, and you're going through that?
Yes. So MS is an as yet uncurable disease that it's basically an autoimmune disease. It has been stable since shortly after they diagnosed me. I'm on an incredible treatment that has kept it stable.
Is it like relapsing remitting, or what type is it?
It's relapsing remitting, and I've not had a single relapse. And I've actually, my symptoms have lessened over time while I've been on this treatment. And it's a treatment that's been around nearly 20 years and is incredibly effective. I also have a very healthy diet and exercise that help keep my inflammation low and all of that stuff. And living my life's purpose, which is a big part of why I retired from business ownership and got into this, has also been incredibly helpful. But no, it is not. I believe eventually there will be a cure. Every day they're coming up with new and more innovations and treatments. But as of right now, it is a lifelong thing. It is not a death sentence. It's a life sentence. Mm.
Yeah. And that's great because you see others with it who are struggling.
Well, our buddy Jack Osborne.
Correct.
He's done a lot of public media about his MS and his journey and all that bullshit as well. Yeah.
Selma Blair and those. And, you know, before you came on and I was reading up on you, I didn't know. And after talking to you, it was like, holy shit, this does not seem like a guy with MS. I wanted to ask you about it because you're one of the sharpest people we've had on this show.
We have a lot of dummies out here.
Well, it's part of our show too. But that's great to hear. That is great news to hear. And yes, I'm with you. I think there will be a cure in the future. And then lastly, the most interesting fact I read about you was that you actually got your nickname Spike at the age of 3 from a character in My Little Pony.
Yeah, are you a brony? Are you a brony, bro?
So it is argued that I am the original brony because I was changing my name. But I was actually changing my name at the age of 3. Just to keep in mind how libertarian I am. At the age of 3, I changed my name after watching a movie. I declared that I was now Spike. My parents went along with it. They figured it was a phase. I'm now 38 years old. So if it was a phase, it's an incredibly long one. I will say, if your definition of brony is keeping up with the brony community, I am not a brony. I have not been continuing to follow it. That was very much a something that I was much more into as a child.
Well, but yeah, that's where it belongs.
I was the beginning of the brony movement by actually changing my name to an MLP character. So I guess to that, I am the OB. If you go by that definition.
Yeah, that's original brony. Now's the point in the show we get to the drinking bro of the week, which is someone who has inspired or helped you become the person you are today. Spike, who would you like to give the drinking bro of the week to?
Who inspired me the most in my life?
Yeah. Who has helped you kind of shape the person you are today?
Oh, my mother. My mother has been, and with no disrespect to my father, I love my father very much. He's been very instrumental in my life. But my mother has been the one who has taught me my moral compass, who has taught me how to be honest and to have a good work ethic and to be forthright in all things and to remember that our actions are reflective of the kind of legacy that we want to leave behind. I mean, there's so many people. I mean, my wife, my father, there's a ton of people that have been incredibly instrumental. If I had to pick a single person that over the course of my entire life has been the most instrumental without fail, it is my mother.
That's awesome, man.
And her name is Trish Cohen.
Trish Cohen. I love you. Shout out to Trish Cohen.
Yeah, and fuck you, Dad.
Yeah.
Thanks for nothing. Thanks for nothing, Dad.
You gave me nothing.
Dad watches everything I do. He's going to call me after this and go, really?
I got to be honest, Spike. You're one of the most fascinating people we've got to sit with. And we highly enjoyed this conversation. I wish the best of luck to you, in all honesty. Anybody who's out there trying to take on the system, I wish the best of luck because, look, let's face it, all odds are against you. But it takes somebody to stand up and at least try to start the movement.
And I think now more than ever before, like after there have been two instances this year where everybody in America was like, what the fuck? One of them was the guy kneeling on George Floyd's neck for 8 minutes.
Right.
Everybody in America was like, nope, not that one. Like this is not the hill we're going to die on right here.
Right.
And the other one was Tuesday night after that debate.
Yeah.
Everybody in America was like, what the fuck did I just watch?
Yep.
Is this really what we're doing here? Like I've never felt Jake Tapper and Dana Bash have never agreed on anything in the history of humanity. Two people like them have never agreed on one thing in politics, especially lately. And they both said the same thing. This was a fucking train wreck. It was a shit show dumpster fire, whatever you want to call it. I think people are primed more now to hear about this stuff in America than they ever have before.
Right. Yeah, I am too. Where can everybody find you on social media and read about your policies and your messaging?
So I want to say, first of all, that I, for one, will not sully the good name of train wrecks by comparing it to that debate two nights ago. But in terms of how you can find us, if you like what you heard, you want to find out more, our website is Joe20. That's JO20.com. You can find out about our issues there. If you'd like to join our team, we have a volunteer form you could fill out. If you want to find out more about our policies, what we're putting forward, I invite you to join me on my social media, on my Facebook. My YouTube channel is a great source of information about, if you're wondering after watching this, but what do libertarians think about this? What do they think about that? What do they think about? I have a ton of videos on there, new ones coming every few days that answer all of those questions, including the age-old question, is milk in cereal a form of soup? And the answer is yes, it is a
gazpacho. Oh, don't start with that shit. No, it's not. And hot dog is not a sandwich. This is the debate that needs to be had. Fuck all this political bullshit. Hot dogs are not sandwiches and cereal's not soup. By the way, you put the cereal in the bowl, then you pour the milk over the top of it. If you're doing it any other way, you're crazy.
Yeah.
Then you're a sociopath. Then there's something wrong with
you. Yeah, there's something wrong
with that. No, we agree on that 100%. If you want to find out more about us, joe20.com is the website. Mm. Spike Cohen on social media, Facebook, YouTube, Instagram. I'm on TikTok for the kids. Be sure to check us out, and I would love to hear any thoughts that anyone has. Come out to my events. If you go to a Spike Cohen page on Facebook and go to the events section, you'll see all the places that I'm going to be. If I'm anywhere near you, come on out. I do Q&A, at least an hour of Q&A at every single stop I do. I'd love to have your question and be able to answer it directly to you, and I appreciate your time.
If you want to do a TikTok with Spike Cohen, classy, bougie, ratchet style, you can – show up the one.
If you want to do the Tuesday slide with Spike Cohen, you can feel free to do it. Spike Cohen, we appreciate your time today. We know you were a busy man, and thanks for agreeing to do the show. It was an absolute blast. For Spike Cohen, D'Anthony Holloway, I'm Ross Patterson. This is the Drinking Bros. Good night, everyone.